hey juniors, you are watching the chapters 3, 4, and 5 lecture video of Malcolm Gladwell's Outliers. It's going to be a very quick video. I'm really essentially just helping you identify the claims that Gladwell makes in chapters 3, 4, and 5. Ideally and essentially, you are able to analyze rhetorically Gladwell's argument within each chapter, specifically applying that skill to your argument progression project, where you are looking at the structure of how he organizes his ideas, what he says, the content, and also the choices he makes to convince his readers to agree with his particular claim. And so just be mindful of that. I'm gonna go ahead and move over here so I can edit my PowerPoint slide so that you can kind of follow along. And so we'll start. So chapters 3, 4, and 5 are a continuation of the subclaim of success comes from opportunity. And 3 and 4 are kind of focused on genius. And so with chapter 3, The Trouble of the Geniuses, part 1, Gladwell essentially brings up the idea that we, I guess, as a majority, as a society, we tend to correlate success with IQ. The higher your IQ, the more successful you are. If you are intelligent, that means you're going to be successful. And while he doesn't dispel that, he definitely says that IQ plays a part in success for many people. He kind of essentially brings us to the idea that the relationship between success and IQ really only works up to a point, that IQ has a threshold in terms of success. That once you've met, I guess, this minimum threshold of where you could achieve success, whether you have an incredibly high IQ, like 180 off the charts, or versus like 150, which is still really good, it doesn't really make a difference in terms of how successful you're gonna be. Like a person who has 180 is not gonna be better than a 150. That at some point, it just doesn't matter. And once you're there, that you can still achieve the success and become an outlier. And of course, he provides evidence through Langen, through various studies, through the colleges that have produced Pulitzer Prize winners, and then the UMich lawyers in terms of who was successful and who wasn't. So that was essentially chapter 3. Chapter 4, of course, then focuses on geniuses and kind of builds on that, because he kind of mentions and makes note that just because you had a high IQ does not mean that you are successful per se. It really matters in terms of your practical intelligence if you also have that as well. And so he, through his examples and through his, I guess, studies and findings, he noticed that those with high IQs who were not successful lacked this culture with practical intelligence. They lacked this background where they were able to learn practical intelligence. And being able to define practical intelligence is helpful, so make sure you do that in the book. But this idea essentially then becomes like people do not just come alone and defy the odds of being success once they're smart. That there is a history in terms of where you grew up, your family background, your culture, and were you given the opportunity to be taught practical intelligence? And he kind of swings back to a lot of the cases in chapter 3. He follows up with Langen. He adds Oppenheimer, other families with similar, I guess, backgrounds, and then essentially kind of talks about that. I would say, though, that you could argue or at least address the idea that you also have to define what success means, right? Because success is kind of a very subjective idea. Success can mean different things to different people. Like what I find successful might be not be the same. And so you almost have to have this definition of, well, what is success? Like, is it wealth? Is it money? Is it prestige? I don't know. So that's just something to think about. I don't know. Just thoughts. And finally, chapter 5 ends with the 3 lessons of Joe Flom. And they kind of all, these 3 lessons from this Jewish lawyer, all kind of bring us down to the claim where Gladwell essentially says that people who are successful become successful because, not in spite of, because of their humble origins. Their generation, their culture, their family history, all gave them these unique opportunities that other people might not have received. And so he utilizes Joe Flom and other Jewish lawyers in New York City around the time that Joe Flom was, you know, kind of breaking out. But the idea of being Jewish and being a disadvantaged minority at the time and how that became an opportunity. And they did it when Joe Flom was born, when others were born, it was their demographic luck, right? Their time of like that place, that time in history that led them to kind of be able to ride the wave of what worked for them. And also finally, I guess the garment industry and meaningful work, that it wasn't about how much money you made. Like it wasn't about that, you know, maybe office cubicle life, but really whether the work was fulfilling, that you've met that three criteria of autonomy, of complexity and connection. You can't really be an outlier if you don't have that meaningful work maybe. So those are essentially the different claims of 3, 4, and 5. If this was like too short for you and you're like, I need more, I need to answer, I need more answers or whatever, please come to the live lectures or office hours and I can definitely help you. But essentially I just kind of want to go over that. And also just as a quick update for your argument progression project, I do need each of you to touch base with me at some point this week, March 30th to April 3rd. I want to know that, one, have you chosen your, you know, chapter? Two, have you read it? And three, have you finally organized your argument, or at least Gladwell's argument, and then you've started brainstorming? Like, I want you to be working on your project bit by bit and, you know, not procrastinating. Okay, so don't forget, you have everything due Sunday. And if you have any questions, just, you know, email me or chat me or whatever. Okay, that's it. Keeping it short and sweet. It's under 8 minutes, which is awesome. And I didn't mess up too much with my speaking and my dogs didn't bark a bajillion times. Oh my gosh, that was... spoke too soon. It's okay. It's the end. All right, well, I will see y'all later. Hope you're having a great week. And that's it. Bye.